I want to invite you and your house church to find your Bibles and take them out, and I want to encourage you to read out of 1 Samuel chapter 17, the story of David and Goliath. The story of David and Goliath. This is going to be the key story that we look at starting today and over the next few weeks as we look at what it means to see, sense, sort, select, and seize opportunities. And today I want to talk to you about what do we do when opportunity knocks. What do we do when opportunity knocks? Using the story of David and Goliath as our overview. So go to 1 Samuel chapter 17. I want to pray for you as you get ready to read the scripture and praise God together. And then you do that. A timer will come up on the screen. You can just ignore it. Take as much time as you read through the story. Talk with one another about what you hear. And then come back for this conversation about what do we do when opportunity knocks. Almighty God, would you, as we've already been praying, take your word. Your promise to us is that your word will accomplish the purpose for which it's sent forth. As we read it, may your spirit be our guide. May he speak deep into our hearts. May he show and reveal to us. May we have ears to hear and hands and feet to obey about how we're supposed to behave, how we're supposed to make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Father, we love you. May you go in front of, walk alongside, and come behind us to let your word accomplish its purpose. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. A man and his dog returned home from a walk through the woods, and they were covered in those little cockleburrs. You know what those cockleburrs are, those things that get stuck everywhere. These tiny burrs had clung to the man's pants and to his dog's fur, and it took a long time to disentangle them all. The man, his name was George de Mestral, was impressed by how easily the burrs had latched on to the two travelers. Later that day, he examined the burrs underneath a microscope, and he noted the numerous minuscule hooks enabling the burrs to grasp the hair or the clothing. He was struck then with an idea. What if he could manufacture one material covered in tiny little hooks like the burrs, and another material to attach it to composed of small loops like the woven fabric of his trousers? Then the two strips of synthetic material would serve as a fastener, sort of like a zipper. De Mestral felt the idea had merit, and he took initiative to create a prototype in the hopes of patenting it. Friends warned him about the project and said it was foolhardy and it would lead him nowhere, but he pressed on, undaunted by their skepticism. Now, to turn his idea into a commercial success, De Mestral had to figure out a way to inexpensively manufacture the material for his fastener. His initial attempts at mass production failed, but he remained committed to the achievability of his idea. After much trial and error, De Mestral finally found the right materials. More than 7 years after his walk through the woods, he received the patent for his invention. And you already know what it is, right? That's right, Velcro. De Mestral's story and the story of David and Goliath help us understand how successful leaders, how successful people see and seize the opportunities that are in front of them. For De Mestral and for David, one day opportunity came knocking. And how they responded and how we respond when opportunities come knocking help us see how we can take advantage of the opportunities God sends our way, how we can understand in the story of David and Goliath a framework for seeing, sensing, sorting, selecting, and seizing the opportunities. So over the next few weeks, we're going to take a look at that. But today, I want us to look at a few things we learn about what we should do when opportunities come knocking. So I just want to share these in general, and I hope we're going to move fast. You take some notes, and you can discuss these as a house church at the end. At the end of our conversation. The first thing I want us to see is this, that right attitudes precede right opportunities. Right attitudes precede right opportunities. I really want to say it this way. Obedience precedes right opportunities. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 17 says this. One day, Jesse said to David, "Take this basket of roasted grain and these 10 loaves of bread and carry them quickly to your brothers." Now you understand the context that David's three brothers were with King Saul and the Israelite army preparing to fight the Philistines. And David was home taking care of the family business, taking care of the shepherd business, when David's father came to him and said, "Hey, take this food to your brothers and to their army commanders." And David simply obeyed his father. David did not go to the front lines of the war with a plan to fight Goliath. This was a God-chosen opportunity. This was a moment when an opportunity came knocking. And David would not have gotten to that opportunity without simple obedience to his father's request. This is the challenge. This challenge is the challenge that directed the rest of David's life and of his nation for generations to come. And David would have never gotten to be the leader that he was if he had not been ready for this opportunity when it came knocking. And he wouldn't have been ready for this opportunity if he hadn't simply been obedient to his father's request. You might be waiting for an opportunity. You might be waiting for an opportunity to come knocking. You hope it's just going to drop in your lap. But you won't see it if you're not being obedient. And so the question for you today, as you're waiting for an opportunity to come knocking at your door, is this. Are you being obedient to what the Father has already said and what the Father has already asked you to do? I don't have to give you any illustrations. You know, as a follower of Jesus, when God and through His Spirit speaks into your heart and He asks something of you, and sometimes it's a really simple task. Say a kind word like we talked about last week. Encourage somebody. Use your money to do good. Trust the Lord and do good. There are things that the Father has already asked you to do, and I just want to ask you, are you being obedient to what the Father has already asked? The second thing I want you to think about when it comes to opportunities that come knocking is this. Initiative activates opportunities. Initiative activates opportunities. The expression that opportunities come knocking indicates that we really aren't looking for them, that one day on the door we just hear somebody sees them. And when they come knocking, we have the opportunity to answer the door or not. If we hesitate, we procrastinate, the person that's knocking seems to go away. Leaders who seize opportunities take action. They open the door to the opportunity and they find out what it's about and they move through it. One of the things when we talk about initiative is this, that David acted fast. He didn't delay. David didn't hesitate to step forward while everyone else was frozen in fear. The two armies had been facing each other for over a month, and daily the giant was coming out and insulting their God and insulting them. And when David saw this opportunity knocking, he took the initiative. Verse 26 of chapter 17 of 1 Samuel says this. David asked the men standing near him, "What will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" David took the initiative, like, hey, what's going to happen to the guy who's going to go out and fight this battle? Then later on, verse 32, David said to Saul, "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him." David hadn't had this plan. He didn't have a battle plan drawn up. He just simply said, there is an opportunity knocking and I will take initiative and I will go do it because that's what I'm supposed to do. People who are ready for opportunities are comfortable with risk and they know that speed matters. Is there an area of your life where God is asking you to do something, an opportunity is knocking, and you've just been hesitating? If you hesitate, you won't hear the knock much longer. Third, I want you to understand this. Opportunities are a result of pluck, not luck. Last week, we looked at the word pluck as one of the things that we had to do to learn to pluck and strum the hearts of others with encouragement. Today, we use the word pluck in a different way. This word pluck, I'm using it with this definition. Pluck is spirited and determined courage. Spirited and determined courage. And when you see an opportunity knocking, to take advantage of it, it requires pluck, this spirited and determined courage. Verse 33 of 1 Samuel 17, Saul replied, "You're not able to go out to Philistine to fight him. You're only a young man, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued it from the sheep, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. your servant has killed both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. That's pluck. Then Saul says, okay, if you're going to do that, here's what I want you to do. I want you to fight in my armor. So David tried on Saul's armor, and David said to Saul, I can't go in these because I am not used to them. So he took them off. Then he took his staff in his hand, chose 5 smooth stones from the stream, put them in the pouch of his shepherd's bag, and with a sling in his hand, he approached the Philistine. David capitalized because he was ready to move with pluck. He was ready to take this determined and spirited thing forward. David capitalized on his unique strength and resisted the temptation to follow anybody else's pattern of fighting. David refused to exchange his sling for the king's armors. When it comes to taking advantage of opportunities that come knocking on our door, we understand that we know our strengths and we can rely on them to fulfill our mission. I guess what I'm saying is this: God had been preparing David for this moment through everything else that he had been through. And David says, the lion, the bear, and God says, I'm preparing you. When that opportunity comes knocking, do not be afraid, because if the opportunity comes knocking and if it's for me, you will be ready for it. Rely on your strengths. Rely on what God has prepared you for, and you will fulfill your mission. Next thing I want us to understand as we take a look at this, when we talk about opportunities that come knocking, is this: opportunity without commitment will be lost. Opportunity without commitment will be lost. Verse 37. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. And as the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet him. There's that pluck again. Reaching into his bag and taking out a stone, he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell face down on the ground. So David triumphed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone. Without a sword in his hand, he struck down the Philistine and killed him. And David ran and stood over him, and he took hold of the Philistine's sword and drew it from the sheath. And after he killed him, he cut off his head with the sword. I would say to you this: this was not beginner's pluck. David knew how to fight a battle. And David knew that he had to seize the opportunity that was knocking. I think it's important to understand that David knew he would win, but I don't think David expected to accomplish his goal in the first attempt. If he would have, he would have only taken one stone. But David took 5 stones to fight this one giant because experience had taught him that sometimes first attempts are rarely successful. But David was willing to make a mid-course adjustment if needed and move forward, which he really did, right? Because he didn't go with a sword in his hand. He went and he had to take the giant sword and use the giant sword to finish him off. As we move through opportunities that come knocking, we understand that during implementation, we need to stay nimble enough to change and adjust as needed. We talked about that in a previous talk, as we talked about one of the problems of missing opportunities that knock on our door is inflexibility. And I think David was flexible to fight according to his strength and the way God had taught him. One of the things I want you to understand, that when you step into an opportunity, when it comes knocking, I want you to know that there will be opposition. Look up at verse 28, 1 Samuel 17 with me. It says, when Eliab, David's oldest brother, heard him speaking with the men, he burned with anger at him and asked, why have you come down here? With whom did you leave the few sheep in the wilderness? I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. You came down only to watch the battle. When you step up and you step into an opportunity to this knocking, be prepared for the opposition. In fact, I'd put it this way: every opportunity will have opposition. Anytime you try to do good, someone will oppose it. Maybe, likely, someone that's very close to you, a parent, a spouse, your peers. They are going to say to you what David's brother said to him: who in the world do you think you are? And David understood this. He wasn't there to watch the battle. He didn't come with a plan. He saw an opportunity knocking, and because of the size of his God, he stepped forward into that opportunity. Let me encourage you, even in the midst of opposition, let the size of your God determine the size of your goal. Give your life to the greatest purpose in the world, living for God's will. And when you do that, you will have enemies, you will have critics, and Satan will want you to be limited and waste your life on trivia and make no impact on this planet. Don't be afraid of the opposition. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, 9, Paul writes this. He said, there is a wide open door for great work here, although many oppose me. When you answer that knocking door of opportunity, people will oppose you. Over the years, I've learned this, and I continue to learn this over and over again. It's kind of a formula. It's this: opportunity plus opposition equals God's will. If there is no opposition, I would submit to you that it's likely might not be from God. People need to understand that when God knocks with an opportunity, there will be opposition and there will be criticism. I think the churches doing the most good are the places where Satan fights the hardest. The people that are making the greatest impact face the greatest resistance. I've learned this the long way. When opportunity comes knocking and you're trying to step into it, or you're leading a group of people to step into it, I've learned this. If you're going to call the shots, you will take the shots. And you shouldn't fear that. David walked unaccompanied into the valley to face Goliath. And his life and his reaction to this knocking door of opportunity was on full display for all to see, both his advocates and his adversaries. And it was mainly his adversaries who spoke up before the victory. You can't be afraid to open the door when opportunity is knocking and see if it's God on the other side. Friends, great opportunities bring great responsibility. How do we respond to those? David approached this great opportunity with great confidence. David trusted God. Verse 37 again, the Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of the Philistine. When we answer that door of knocking opportunity, it's our opportunity to trust God that he's brought the right opportunity, and we can step into it with confidence. This eventful day when David and his sling conquer the giant may be the most often related story from the Old Testament. From businesses to sports, people talk about David and Goliath, and it's become a metaphor to describe improbable success. The message often shared from this epic encounter is this, as most tell it, underdogs can be victorious over the powerful. But that's not the point of this story. The takeaway from this story, and the point of this story, is this: Goliath never had a chance because God was on David's side. The battle was the Lord's. The battle wasn't David. And when opportunities come knocking and they appear to be blocked by giants, we can, like David, run towards the opportunity with confidence, knowing that God is on our side. But remember, this moment that changed David's life and his leadership and the life of his nation that would last for generations was launched in humble obedience to the Father's simple command, take this food to your brothers. Was launched in dependence on the Lord for every concern. Verse 47 of chapter 17 says this, David speaking, he says, all those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. Jesus, on one occasion, was speaking, Luke chapter 12, and he says this, when someone has been given much, much will be required in return. When someone has been entrusted with much, even more will be required. Even much more. Those words are the ones I want you to think about when opportunity comes knocking. When God comes knocking on your door with opportunity, it's because he's entrusted you with much. He's prepared you for much. And when he gives you a bigger opportunity, even much more will be required. God expects more from those he blesses more. And you listening today, you're in the much more category. If you have any change in your pocket or in a cup sitting on your desk, you're wealthier than 92% of the world. And you've been blessed to be a blessing. And an opportunity is going to come knocking on your door to bless someone else. When opportunity comes knocking, be ready. Run towards it with confidence that the battle is not yours, it is the Lord's, and everybody will be astonished. There may be an opportunity knocking at your door right now, and it's the opportunity for salvation. Revelation says that Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears me and opens the door, I will come in and dine with them, and they with me. Is Jesus knocking at the door of your heart today? Is he offering you salvation? Yes. If you've never said yes to Jesus, the scriptures say, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And we need salvation because we are sinners. We've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And God said, I sent Jesus to live a life of perfection, die a death on a cross, and rise from the dead. I've shared with you over the last few weeks some of the saddest words in all of the scriptures from Jeremiah. The harvest is finished, the summer is gone, and the people cry, yet we are not saved. Do not let that be you. Do not let that be you. You have an opportunity as knocking at your door to say yes to the salvation of Jesus Christ. And he says, if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Don't miss that opportunity today. And if you're a follower of Jesus and you are saved and you're surrendered to the Spirit, get ready. There's going to be an opportunity knocking at your door, and you can run towards the opportunity with confidence because God loves you. But it starts with simple obedience. What is God asking you to do today? Obey that and then be amazed at the opportunity that will be knocking at your door very soon. Almighty God, thank you. Thank you that you have prepared us. As we've simply been obedient, you prepared us for the opportunity that's coming. And you want us to make the most of every opportunity because these are evil days. And Father, running towards an opportunity is the only right thing because the victory is yours. You are on our side. And so we want to answer the door of the opportunity that's knocking. But it starts with humble and simple obedience to the Father's request. So God, right now you're speaking to each of our hearts. Your Spirit's moving. May the conversation that takes place in the house churches, God, just be that that says, here's an opportunity. I think God's putting at my door. I hear the knocking. Let's go. Father, you're doing that individually. You're doing it in our hearts. You're doing it in our homes. You're doing it in our community. You're doing it in our church family. God, may we be faithful to run towards the opportunity you bring our way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.